Okay, here
Wait,
we go.
What? What do you mean you haven't played Space Quest before?
See, I told you not to say anything about it.
So the chances are, if you are a fan of adventure games, you've heard about the series before and probably in a positive light. It's renowned as one of the best titles in the genre. Let's say my hopes are rather high on this one. The reason why adventure games are still fondly remembered is mainly because of their writing, which people often confuse with story for some reason, and or their excellent world building and atmosphere. Quest for Glory games, Larry, Monkey Island, Day of the Tentacle, Full Throttle, and so on, there is something about puzzle solving that lends itself to those types of games. It's much easier to connect with the world when, instead of running room by room, guns a-blazing, you interact with your environments in a relatable fashion. Everything you see might be an item, a puzzle, or a point of interest. It's good that I looked. So how does Space Quest hold up in that regard? Not very. In fact, it's rather uninspiring. The writing, for example, is occasionally witty, but 95% of the time it's completely straight-faced. The atmosphere is functional. There is enough recognizable imagery to establish a stereotypical sci-fi setting upon which the player may project his vision of what a science fiction adventure should be, thus making up for its shortcomings with his imagination. It's not King's Quest, by any means. For example, remember how the characters were basically acting like talking signs because the game couldn't handle a more sophisticated interaction with them? Well, Space Quest actually makes a rather interesting choice of making all living characters in the game pretty much ignore the protagonist, reflecting how unimportant he is both in their eyes and in the grand scheme of things. You are just a janitor that got in way over his head and is now stranded on a desert planet. It's interesting, don't get me wrong, but I wouldn't play this game if atmosphere was all it was going for.
The story is also merely there. So far the odds don't look favorable for this classic. Yeah, there seems to be no reasons to be playing it. Maybe the gameplay will be the saving grace that turns the table, so to speak. So how does it hold up?
You are such a tool, George.
Shush!
Well, this game is unforgiving. Very. In fact, the game seems to relish murdering you. There is an unreasonable amount of optional objects that serve an exclusive purpose of killing you. And pretty much every mistake here is punishable by death, if you're lucky, because if not, you'll become subject to the dead man walking syndrome. What was labeled under this title is what Sierra Games became infamous for. It goes like this. You know how in order to solve a puzzle, you need to find the corresponding item. So if you miss this item, you get stuck, until you pixel hunt your way through the already visited locations and stumble upon the needed item. But what if you couldn't revisit those locations? What if they were locked off due to the story progression, leaving you literally stranded with no ability to progress, forcing you to replay the game from the very beginning, yet now making sure to pick up the missed item? Sounds pretty harsh, doesn't it? In fact, that is absolutely ridiculous. What is more agitating than getting stuck so badly you'll have to go through the entire game again, just to pick up a shovel or something? Well, as far as adventure games are concerned, nothing. This is the most punishing and hated game mechanic ever invented in the genre. Now, don't forget, this is a puzzle game, so there is going to be some ambiguity when it comes to what can qualify as a mistake. Not only that, Space Quest uses the text insert interface, meaning that virtually anything is on the table when it comes to those puzzles, making it even more cryptic. And yeah, now you have some clue as to how punishing and unforgiving this game truly is. Every step of the way, there is a possibility of you making a fatal mistake that will force you to start the game all over again, and I nearly forgot. There is often some sort of a time limit on your actions that prevents you from being too careful. Have fun!
This here is the reason why so many people hate Sierra adventure games. It's not the geographics nor the text inset interface that I've already defended so much in my King's Quest review. It's the dead man walking syndrome, and that alone. Isn't that right, Seal?
Yes.
But what if I want to play a game like this?
What if I do want a challenge? What if I'm tired of knowing that an adventure game is holding back on me and, in doing so, waters down the satisfaction of puzzle solving? What if I want heavier stuff? A game that is considered hardcore even among adventure game fans. A real challenge, something that is actually meant to defeat you rather than make you feel good. So that if I do beat it, I will know that this victory means something. What if I want an adventure game that is making it clear that if I don't pay my fullest attention and play as carefully as I can, if I don't become 100% present and completely invest myself in the gameplay, I will not be able to beat the game? What if this premise appeals to me?
It starts to feel like you are just indirectly bragging about yourself for beating this game.
Oh, has it? Well, I'll have you know that I've looked up several solutions during my playthrough. 3, to be exact. Yeah. That's just that. Why am I bragging for just honestly sharing my feelings towards those types of games?
Nowadays, this very cruelty is what turns it into such an interesting gameplay experience. It's exciting, thrilling to be playing a game in which you have to make no mistakes, in which you have to act like the protagonist of a film or a book, to think and by thinking overcome challenges that actually qualify as such. I've previously described how the appeal of puzzle solving is the possibility of failure. Real failure, the one in which you have to admit defeat and look up solutions, and how because of that the challenge feels tangible and victory over it feels meaningful. Well, in Space Quest you get this, but on steroids. Now there are even higher stakes at play. It's a challenge of getting stuck for real. People consider LucasArts titles to be an improvement over those old ones, and it's true in a lot of ways, but not really, because if they are just straight up better, there would be no reason to play the old ones. They would be lesser in every single way, yet when I played Quest for Glory 2 in 2013, and later Legends with Larry, it felt like a breath of fresh air. It felt new and different.
Doesn't sound terribly one-sided. I mean, people hate those games because it's agitating to get stuck like that. But what if you don't get stuck? What if knowing that you could get stuck at any point during your playthrough not only made the experience more exciting, but made it more satisfying to complete?
Granted, you might consider me insane for something like this, but let's face it, the only reason you'd play an 80s adventure game is because you've already played your fair share of Broken Swords, Monkey Islands, and Gabriel Knights. You know how to play those games, and how to actually solve them. So if you come to a point when you are actually considering investing time in Space Quest, it means you are already pretty capable of handling this difficulty, and in fact, you'd welcome it. It's somewhat of a natural progression. You've just moved on to more difficult games in your genre of choice. What's insane about that? Yet this is something that non-adventure fans seem to not get. That you might be playing a Sierra game because of its ridiculous gameplay. Because you like cryptic bullshit puzzle solving along with its stupid moon logic, and you want more of it.
That's a pretty small niche you've crawled into.
Oh, I crawl between several. But yeah, it's a specific game for a specific audience. Today, I mean. Back in the 80s, it was just the only thing available for a lot of people. But now, and this is the important part, now it can finally find its true audience.
Now, it's going to be difficult to describe, but numerous deaths, the necessity of constant savings, the possibility of getting stuck are all there specifically to increase the player's attention and improve his enjoyment of the game. It makes you feel vulnerable. It raises the stakes of play, adding an element of danger to the experience, making it more exciting. In Monkey Island, you can walk around the island touching everything and standing anywhere and not care. Here, you can't afford not to care, because you can get stuck. The important part here is that it's somehow easier to pay attention to the game, to focus, when the assumption is that you can get stuck if you don't. It's human psychology, basically. The natural state in Monkey Island and the like is to relax, to chill and simply play. And in that state, you can easily miss something very noticeable. And it takes effort on the player's part to go against this natural inclination and force himself to be attentive to the gameplay. Here, when there are high stakes, high as they can be in adventure game, it is your natural state to pay 100% attention to everything. It becomes difficult not to. And this is the key here, attention and focus. Those are the reasons why the possibility of getting stuck is a positive element of this game, without which it wouldn't work. Because of this heightened attention, your involvement in the game increases, and every aspect of it becomes amplified as a result. Every victory becomes twice as satisfactory, every bit of flavor text becomes twice as absorbing, every animation and graphic twice as eye-catching, and the resulting atmosphere as a whole twice as immersive. And you could say that all this does is makes up for the technological limitations of such a primitive game, but it's more than that. It's an entire new gameplay sensibility that feels completely unlike anything the user-friendly point-and-clicks can throw at you.
Well, if I like this genre so much, then why did I criticize King's Quest so heavily? Well, that's because that's how you actually should be criticizing art. You don't condemn an entire genre, but just bad examples of it.
King's Quest was bad, not because text-insert puzzle solving in itself is bad, but because it's a bad text-insert adventure game. It's bad within its genre, when compared to superior titles. For instance, the strengths of such gameplay in comparison to point-and-clicks is that every action is possible. Every action a human being could do might be utilized, which is why you can actually think like a human being and solve a problem via common sense. What stood in the way of King's Quest in achieving this goal were the limited vocabulary that prevented you from enacting solutions you already figured out, and the lack of feedback, which essentially blindfolded you. Space Quest, on the other hand, is much more lenient when it comes to the text parser, so there won't be anything quite as bad as the situation with the giant. What's really important, though, is how much better this game is in terms of feedback. Every room gives you detailed descriptions when you look around, and everything that is mentioned within that description can be further examined on its own. There's something fundamentally satisfying about looking around the room, noticing a console in a corner, examining the console to see that it has various buttons, levers, slots, and monitors, with each one of which you can interact by directly addressing it in a sentence. It's really neat. Honestly, isn't there something special about a game that can make a simple button press to open a door feel like an entire event? What is interesting is that, unlike King's Quest 2 that would list interactable objects in a separate text, here those objects are integrated into the room descriptions themselves. This not only makes the world feel much more cohesive, since those items feel like integral parts of their environments, but creates an interesting dynamic. You can possibly miss something in the description by just not paying enough attention to it. When the console is mentioned briefly in the middle of a text bubble, your eyes might gloss over it. And that's what's cool. Your attention span gets tested here. This challenge gets even more pronounced when several objects in the game are not mentioned in the general room descriptions. I know, right? For example, you can't just look around to see the survivor's kit in the escape pod. You have to look specifically at the pod itself. Otherwise, you won't find this survival kit. And you need this item, believe me. But usually this is not as bad. For example, you have to look at floor or ground to see the chunks of the creature's body after it explodes. The difference, right, between this and the Clover situation in King's Quest is that here, it's an exception, and that exception is present only when the item in question is clearly visible. There was no chunk here before, after all. I know I sound like an apologist, but because of those exceptions, there is now an incentive to actually, you know, look with your eyes and not just with the text parser. You can't rely solely on room descriptions now, and that is important since it prevents Space Quest from feeling like an Infocom adventure. You have to be attentive, not just towards text, but also visuals.
Space Quest walks a very fine line, so to say. It never goes overly transparent with its environments, which would make it too easy. Nor does it go deliberately silent, withhold information from the player, which would make it borderline unplayable. So yeah, Space Quest is a challenging game, but it's fair.
So the two problems of its predecessor are no longer an issue here. However, this game doesn't stop there. In King's Quest, a surprising amount of puzzles is solved with the repeated usage of the words give and throw. Considering how few puzzles are in that game, it really puts into question the entire game as a whole. What is the value of incorporating the entire English vocabulary when you're going to use just two verbs the entire time? What is the point of using the text parser interface when you are not going to capitalize upon its defining gimmick? Space Quest is radically different in that regard. Almost every new puzzle requires not just a different item, but a different action to be performed with said item. There is more than a dozen various verbs I had to use during this game, which is why it remains mentally stimulating all the way through.
You never fall into a routine here. You never feel like, you know, you are just repeating the same motions again and again. No, you always have to think and adapt. She's actually related to just how varied this game actually is.
Space Quest isn't split into chapters, however it might as well be. There are four distinct segments which differ quite noticeably from one another. Walking around the ship, searching corpses and manipulating consoles feels rather different to exploring the deserts, mountains and caves, which are much more environmentally driven. You push rocks, hide from monsters, dodge acid drops, and so on. It's remarkable how much variety this game manages to squeeze out of text inset puzzle solving. On the station, it's all about the text parser activity, yet in the desert, your challenge lies more often in positioning and movement of characters than in what you type in. And at the Yulin's Flats, it introduces an entire economy system, with a challenge revolving exclusively around the money management. The danger is not in failing to maneuver away from a killer robot anymore, but in getting tricked or mugged for cash. And then that entire gimmick gets dropped when you have to disguise yourself as a Sarien soldier on the Armada ship.
And imagine that all that you experience in a game with actual stakes at play and with an interface that allows you to do everything. It's honestly insane to think about just how much better this game is than King's Quest already, but there is still more.
First, notice how many screens in this game are doubles. For example, when you enter the cave, you are at the bottom of the screen, unable to get to the upper side because by your accounts it's a different room, but you as a player know that you're going to get there sometime in the future. It's foreshadowing, but of what? There is nothing there worthy of being foreshadowed, you might say, and you'd be right. It's just another room, like any other. but you are still unable to get there right now. It's still something ahead of you, someplace you'll be if you solve a puzzle that prevents you from accessing this place. Now, imagine if this cave was laid out differently, and those upper pathways would just be separate screens that you unlock by solving puzzles. It's the same deal, right? Those were actually different rooms you haven't visited, so it wouldn't be any different, technically. Well, no. When you get to a room that was previously inaccessible, as a consequence of solving a puzzle, what the player feels is that he made progress in the game. Because he saw this room before, because he knew he will get to it sometime in the future, he now feels like this future is now. He progressed to a place that he thought was distant.
As a player, you would get this sense of accomplishment anyway, simply due to your victory over a puzzle. But because of that visual detail, this feeling is now amplified into a much more tangible, immediate sense of awareness of your current place in the overall progression of the game.
It's a subtle difference, but because of this double room feature, the game operates within the terminology of was and will be. It doesn't exist in media res. This screen now has distinct past and future, with the player being aware of his placement along this timeline. If those rooms were just separate screens you unlocked for solving a puzzle, it would all just be one continuous, never-changing now. But because you see at all times where you're going and where you came from, with the puzzle being the distinct obstacle that separates the two, the satisfactory quality of defeating this obstacle becomes much more pronounced, and the sense of progress, which is so important to such games, much more defined and immediately perceivable. However, this is just one example of how this game foreshadows future progress. You can see the planet of Kirona on a monitor screen in the escape pod. You hear about Yulin's flats from aliens, whom themselves are foreshadowed with their holographic projection. There is a lot of details like this, and it all works towards the same sense of progression that makes this game feel like a journey. And yeah, unlike Quest for Glory, Legend of Larry and the other Sierra titles, this game is an actual quest. Weird, I know. This game is linear, and because of that linearity, the player progression becomes highlighted. What I mean is, in a game as uncertain as this, where you're always under the risk of getting stuck, killed, or getting stuck so bad, you'll have to restart the whole game again. Can you imagine how satisfying it is to make, let's call it, hard progress? When you get a flying vehicle, for example, and traverse out of the desert and into the alien town, it means that the desert is now done. You've beaten it, now and forever. Even if you have to replay the game, you will know what to do. You might as well open up a bottle of champagne to celebrate this occasion, except the game is the one that crafted this occasion. It could have easily just set the entire game on the desert or on the space station at the start, and this feeling of progress would not be present. The champagne bottle would not be popped. That is actually how it works in other Sierra titles. In them, it was basically the score that told you how far in the game you are, because the actual location the game takes place in remains the same all the way through. It's still rather effective stuff though. There's something fundamentally satisfying about playing an impenetrable old game like this, and not just managing to get stuff done, but having the game acknowledge your achievements with points.
The score sort of gives texture to puzzle solutions. It punctuates them. It's also somewhat heartwarming to look at the top of your screen and know that, yep, it's indeed working out.
But in Space Quest, it's more than just score. When you solve the final puzzle at the station, you get a prolonged cutscene that culminates in you getting to a completely different place that was inaccessible at the start of the game, which you got to through your skill alone. It's an entire new dimension to that sense of accomplishment for solving puzzles that comes from structuring the game around the linear quest. It's rewarding to have your progress acknowledged in such a way. That is actually why the depressingly mean-spirited atmosphere fits so well here. It reflects the challenge of the game and reinforces the sense of accomplishment for overcoming the said challenge. You are surviving here, and not just that, but against all odds, you are climbing out of the hole you found yourself in on this desert planet, eventually going as far as to reach the status of a galactic hero. As you can see, it's not just the puzzle solving that makes this gameplay rewarding, but also the periphery around it. The foreshadowing, the scoring system, the atmosphere, and the linear structure of the adventure with the distinct transitions between different parts of the game. It's like this entire game subscribes to this philosophy of double screens.
It's like every single thing in this game is working towards the same goal of making the puzzle solutions feel as rewarding as they can possibly be, and they are. I honestly struggle to think of a game that could make a puzzle feel more satisfying than Space Quest does.
The text insert interface forces the player to actually solve the puzzles with logic, aka play the game as it was meant to be played, making it involving. The Dead Man Walking Syndrome raises the stakes of play, making it more exciting while increasing the satisfaction of puzzle solving through increased challenge. This also increases the engagement factor that is derived from the text insert puzzle solving. The game as a whole, foreshadowing of future events, linear structure, mean-spirited atmosphere, is designed around making puzzles more rewarding, so that the already satisfying challenge would become even more satisfying. However, the feedback makes this challenge manageable and fair, as long as the player is attentive and mentally present in the gameplay, which is rather easy since the Dead Man Walking Syndrome.
As you can see, we have a cohesive, functioning system in our hands, where every aspect is working together towards making the game as involving and satisfying as it can be with the given technology and premise.
Interesting. You can list those exact qualities as negatives, and I feel that more people would agree with you.
Well, they are negatives for some, but positives for others. It's a niche game after all. But yeah, what's important though, is that Space Quest validates its difficulty. It's just how engaging and rewarding it is. It is worth the time investment.
Space Quest is not as funny as Larry, or as atmospheric as Trial by Fire, but it's still the best text insert adventure game I've ever played. It's basically this genre's equivalent of Prince of Persia. This perfect, concise, gameplay-driven experience with minimalistic presentation and atmosphere, yet maximum immersion and engagement qualities. It truly feels like a sci-fi adventure with you as the protagonist, who has to constantly think and adapt to the situations he finds himself in, feeling threatened and overwhelmed at some points, triumphant and happy at others, with a whole gradient of states in between. It's a roller coaster of emotions that can only be achieved when the game is not holding back on the player.
This is the game I was looking for. It's the definitive text insert adventure that truly delivers upon the potential of the genre. And for that, Space Quest 1 is a great game. Damn, Seal, that's... I'm so happy. Like, this is the absolute best text adventure game.
George, you say it's the best, but haven't you only played 7 text insert adventure games so far? What about
that's enough for today, I think.
Police Quest 2, Gold.